Ahoy, friends. Welcome to Building the Alpha Dory. I'm Dan, and this is a project to build a sailing dory from John Gardner's book, The Dory Book, and illustrations by Sam Manning. Today we're going to be working on fitting the third plank on the port side, and maybe we'll get to some riveting, we'll see. Anyway, thanks for stopping by, and let's get out into the shop and get to it. So you may have noticed over the course of the build here that there's not a whole lot as far as tools that you really need that sort of the average home builder shouldn't be able to wrangle up to build a traditional dory. Probably the biggest luxury is the space to build. Probably the greatest expense of one of these projects is, just having an area, a place you can call your own and do what you want in. These days, that's the real estate is such an expensive thing. Some time and quite a bit of time too. That's another expensive thing. But yeah, so space and time. But as far as actual tools, similar could probably be bought for I don't know, maybe $500 or a little bit less even if you were kind of took your time to shop around. This is buying secondhand. If you went out and bought equivalent planes and other hand tools firsthand, yeah, you're probably talking like maybe $2,000 worth of tools if you bought them off the shelf new. But all of these planes and saws and clamps and everything can usually, with an investment of time, can be found secondhand pretty easily. If you go to antiques fair or flea market type place. If you're going around to yard sales, you may have to hunt a bit further afield, and they're gonna kind of depends where you are in the country too. What the sort of what you'll be finding at yard sales. I'm in New England, so there's quite a bit of old tools around from the 19, well, even late 1800s on, but most of the stuff is like, say, 1920s, 1930s, 1950s. Just a huge amount of this stuff produced and sold in New England. Produced, sold, and used. So, yeah. supposedly just not so far from here. Pennsylvania area, there's a real kind of lack of hand tools just because there's a fairly robust antiques market. There is here too. But not only that, but the Amish are still using these tools, so they've kind of basically used them up. These tools haven't been made for in any great numbers for like the past 40 years. So pretty much the Amish have bought them all and used them to the point where they're really reaching the end of their life. So, I'm not sure where I was going with that, but oh yeah, just depending on where you are in the country. So supposedly in Pennsylvania area, they're starting to go far afield and look for these old hand tools and basically importing them from other parts of the country. Anyway, that's what I'm told anyhow. So yeah, you can see these this goes together fairly easily with a couple hammers. You're gonna need a ball peen hammer or two for the riveting. Probably two or three different size planes. You know, you'll want a small low angle block plane. You'll want a kind of small bench plane, and you'll want a jointing plane a little bit longer. You can probably get away without that one even. You've got a decent eye. The ability to plane to a straight edge. And then a couple hand saws. Just make sure you get ones that are sharp or have them sharpened. These little cabinetry saws are nice. Hacksaws don't work so bad either, as long as you're able to get them to cut straight. You gotta kind of stay on top of them to get a straight cut out of the blades tend to wander. But if you can, they're great because you know, the blades are cheap and they're nice and sharp when you get them. So that's fitting in there pretty good. This is the little spacer for the other frame on the other side. Let's see, where's a pencil? Yeah, and then, the couple, a hammer or two. It's always nice to have multiples, so when you set one down and lose it, you can always just go back in a hurry and grab another one. Here's a pencil. But, I try to keep all my hammers hung in easy reach so that when I set one down, I'll always just be able to run back and snag another one if I need it in a hurry. And then I've been using a thickness plane, which is pretty essential if you're just getting wood at a sawmill. Got to kind of be able to thickness your planks and your frames and everything else, really. So that's a pretty essential part of the project. Now my thickness plane is pretty cheap. It's a Craftsman portable thickness planer, 13-inch. It was $150 when I bought it used. No. I think I bought it used for $75, and they're around 200 and something new. Supposedly, like, as I was buying it, the guy who sold it to me said that it had already done an entire... It had done the floors for his house, so this thing's been pretty well used, and yeah, it's still working. It's definitely not the best planing experience I've ever had. What's important. Resisting getting out the vise. Probably should. Make it a lot easier to cut this thing.
Okay, pretty good fit there.
And yeah, so you'll see as we put the boat together, these little wedges are, you know, like, I'd kind of like the frame to be touching the plank right there, but yeah, this is just such a big boat that's actually, I've planked it out beyond the frames to some degree. It's going to be a powerful hull, which is going to make it really good under sail. And yeah, she's just, the hull is actually bigger than the framing, which is why these wedges are going in. So ideally, and what I've done is, on the patterns, I actually drew a bit more of length to this frame. And I'm also thinking about maybe trimming the bottom of the pattern so that it's canted up slightly, so you don't get this much shape aft on the next boat. We'll see. So it'll make it a slightly skinnier boat, a little bit less bulk to it, a little bit less beam. But yeah, where these wedges are going in, it's like, you know, you're not even going to see that because you've got the seat riser here, and then the seats will be coming right in here. So it really is, it's just an aesthetic sort of, it's an aesthetic thing because, you know, these blocks are on the frame and the frame is just as strong as ever, and there's a nail going through both. So it's not like it's, it's not like, and then this plank and the plank above it are both landing on the frame, so it's not like it's going to be a weak point at all. It's just, you know, the boat's too big for ribs or frames. So, yeah, and I think that's partly a function of the, like I was saying, I kind of went as big as I could on these, the second plank, the curvature, and I think that's probably why the third plank wasn't able to be an exact copy of the second. So, you know, like they say, but yeah, it'll be a nice, powerful hull, and yeah. So the alternative was try and pull this plank in to hit the frame, in which case you'd get like a back curve in the lap, like a reverse curve, which you definitely don't want to do. It's not going to look good, and then you also endanger cracking the plank along the grain where you're pulling back on it, because it's already riveted and everything. You know, if I could take this plank off and recut the bevel on the frame on the plank below, then, you know, I might be able to allow it to come up and in. It would still be a reverse curve on the, you know, in the hull, which you don't want to do anyway, period. But yeah, anyway. Oh, so let's see if we can get this plank up on the boat and see what it looks like. Clamp, a block of wood, So something I want to do is mark the height of the other plank. So put the square on there. And put the square on this side. Draw a line across there. So it's about where I want my like I did both of these a little bit too tight. Yeah, it looks like we need to go back a little bit further with the entire plank. As you can see. See if that's far enough. Yeah, it is far enough. Just. Okay, so pretty close all along here. All right, so the next next thing to do is to find a straight edge, straight board. Which this is. you don't want something that's gonna flex too much over a distance, over a given distance, you know, over the distance of say 6 feet or so. But then I go to amidships. Okay, so that's pretty good. Just trying to knock this. Pretty close. Just looking at how that's going to pull in. Yeah, so we're pretty close on the, pretty much right on the level there. That lets us know that since the boat is level, that lets us know that our plank edge on both sides is about the same height on the boat, so you don't end up with a lopsided boat. So yeah, that looks good. That's in a good spot. Our next task is nailing that plank on. So we're kind of getting there as far as the shape of the hull. You can see it's really kind of starting to take shape here. And like I say, one more plank to go. That's a shear plank. And then the rail goes on at the shear plank. And then there's a, like I was saying earlier, a seat riser that goes on the inside. It also adds a lot of stiffness. And the seats, of course, that add a ton of stiffness to the hull. But, you know, we're getting close. It looks like to put the next planks on, the last planks, I'm going to have to take the braces off the stem to get in there to cut the stem bevel and to lay those planks in. So, yeah, it's fine at this point. The stem is well braced by all the other planking on it now, and the boat will still be held in position by the uprights that go down to the bed. So, yeah, all right, well, I guess next video we'll be nailing this plank on. Thanks for stopping by building the Alpha Dory. And have a great day, and we'll see you next video. Bye.